Hello friends, welcome to my channel Sales Structures.
In my last video, I explained about types of retaining walls, behavior of retaining walls and the other general information about retaining walls. Today, I will explain you design of retaining wall with detailing drawings. So let's take one example. As you can see, I have already given a problem statement to design a cantilever retaining wall. Which is designed to retain soil of earth of height 5.5 meter above the ground level. The soil having the bearing capacity and the density are respectively given 170 kN per meter square and 18 kN per meter cube. And we have to design all of the components of the retaining wall with all the stability checks. With detailing drawing, we can use M20 grade of concrete and Fe415 of steel. Here we have given phi, which is 30 degree, and phi is nothing but the internal friction of the soil, and also given mu, which is a internal friction of coefficient, and which is given 0.5. Now let's see which are the datas are already given. They already given the height of wall above ground level, and it is 5.5 meter. Soil bearing capacity, it is 170 kN per meter square. Density of soil, which is 18 kN per meter cube. Phi, it means internal friction of the soil, and 30 degree. And mu is the coefficient of friction, which is 0.5, and M20 is and Fe415. And let's also see which are the datas we have to determine. First of all, we have to determine size of all the components of retaining wall: stem height, stem bottom width, stem top width, stem length, depth of foundation, width of the base, and width of heel slab and toe slab. We also have to determine active earth pressure value and passive earth pressure value. We also determine the uplift pressure from the soil at the base of the retaining wall, factor of safety against overturning, and factor of safety against sliding. Now let's see the components of retaining wall with a drawing. You can see here, I have already drawn the cross section of retaining wall. These portion, you can see this trapezoid portion of the wall is called as stem. Okay, and this is nothing but the ground level of backfill and your backfill. It means whatever soil you have to return, it is here. And the other side, the ground level height is somewhere here. What are the datas are given? As we know that we have given the height of wall above ground level is 5.5 meter. So let's see which height we have already given. We have given the height of the wall above ground level. So they have given us this much height of the wall, which is 5.5 meter. We have to determine this total height of the backfill including the base of the retaining wall depth, and this much depth is called as depth of foundation. Now this particular portion we call it as a base of the retaining wall. Let I am giving the particular width of the base denote as B. We have to determine this width. Okay, now this portion of the base width is known as heel slab, and this portion known as toe slab. We also have to determine this particular width of the heel slab. and the toe slab. Basically, we consider the heel slab, which is beneath the backfill. So, as we know that backfill soil is here, and this backfill soil will exert a pressure on this particular portion of the wall, and this pressure will be in a form of triangular manner. Okay, something like this. This pressure called as active earth pressure of the soil. The value will of the this active earth pressure at the base of the triangular portion is Ka gamma h. Here K is nothing but the coefficient of earth pressure, gamma is the density of earth, and h is nothing but the height of the wall. Okay, now we know that if there is any external force on the body, there will be definitely resisting force having same magnitude but in the opposite direction. So if we are we have active earth pressure somewhere here, Pa, I am denoting it for the active earth pressure, so there will be passive earth pressure also in opposite side of the wall, it also in a form of triangular. Okay, and these value will be Kp. It means this is the coefficient of passive earth pressure. Into gamma H1. Here we are considering H1 as this particular height. Gamma is nothing but the density of the soil, we know that. Now first of all, let's calculate these coefficients of earth pressure. So I am writing our step number 1, which is coefficient of earth pressure. They are Ka and Kp. Ka is a coefficient of active earth pressure and Kp is coefficient of passive earth pressure. From the earth pressure chapter from geotechnical engineering of soil, we already know this formula of the Ka, which is 1 minus sine 5 upon 1 plus sine 5. We already know the value of 5, so I am writing it, and it is 30 for this. So 1 minus sine 30 upon 1 plus sine 30, and the total answer is 1 by 3. We also know for the Kp is equal to 1 upon Ka. So our Kp will be 3. Now our step number 2 will be to determine the dimensions of the different components of retaining wall. So here I am writing. So first of all, let's understand which are the dimensions we require here for retaining wall. First of all, let us assume the length of the retaining wall in longitudinal direction. We are assuming it 1 meter. We have to determine height of wall, that is nothing but the total height. we already have the height of the wall above ground level, and it is 5.5 meter. So we have to determine depth of foundation. It is nothing but the height of the wall beneath the ground level. We also have to find the width of the base slab. Which including toe width slab and heel width slab. Now let's first determine the depth of the foundation. It is nothing but the height of the wall under ground level. You can see this much portion. We have to determine this depth of foundation. It means the height of the wall below the ground level. So as per the formula of depth of foundation, we already know this formula from the geotechnical engineering. Let's find D minimum. We have the formula FSBC, it means soil bearing capacity of the soil upon gamma 1 minus sine phi upon 1 plus sine phi whole square. Okay, we have the soil bearing capacities 170, gamma is nothing but 18, 1 minus sine phi value given 30, 1 plus sine 30 and its whole square. So after calculation, I have find the value is something 1.04 meter. And you can see I have already written it is depth of foundation in minimum value. Okay, so I can take, let's round off value. Depth of foundation 1.2 meter. I can round off value whatever I like. Now my second parameter, what I have to find is the base width. Let's see what is the base width in drawing. You can see this one is your base width. So we have to find that distance B. Okay. And for this, our formula we are taking is under root 3P upon 2 gamma. See, all these formulas are we have already discussed, or maybe you already know from the knowledge of geotechnical engineering. Okay, so here what is your P? P is total pressure acting on wall due to backfill. Okay, now let's see what is that. As we have discussed that due to backfill soil, this pressure will be exerted on the wall, and it is something triangular manner. Okay, so we already know this particular length of value, which is K gamma H, and our total pressure is nothing but the area of this particular triangle. Okay, so I am writing what is PA. First of all, let's find this particular value of the pressure. When I am using small p, it is A. It is K gamma capital H. Okay. What is Ka? Is 1 by 3. Gamma is the density of a soil. And what is H? H is total height of retaining wall. I think we are remaining with total height of retaining wall. What is that? Total height is starting from the above ground level to the bottom of the base slab. We know this particular height, which is 5.5, plus this particular depth of foundation. So what do you think our total depth of the retaining wall? It is nothing but capital H is equal to 5.5 plus 1.2. And it is 6.7 meter. Okay. Now let's use this value in this small P of A. 1 by 3, 18, and it is 6.7 meter. So after it is something 40.15. As it is a pressure, I am writing it in kilonewton per meter square. Now for that, let's find total pressure on the wall, active earth pressure. I'm writing it with capital P of A, which is 1 by 2 K gamma H square. And this active earth pressure, we know that it is in a triangular manner. Here it is Ka gamma H, and your active pressure Pa will be acting at H by 3 of the height, and which is a CG of the particular triangle. Okay, so this total pressure on the wall, it will be the area of this triangle. So let's take what is the area of the triangle. It is 1/2 these value K gamma H multiplied by the total height. It is H, and so we can determine it is 1/2 K gamma H square. Let's put the values. K value having 1 by 3, gamma is density of soil, it is 18, and capital H is 6.7 whole square. Okay, and after calculation we can get the value 134.67 kilonewton. Now let's put this value in our formula for base width B, which is under root 3P upon 2 gamma. Okay, 3P is something 134.67, 2 gamma is 18, and after the calculation I get the value something 3.35 meters. So these 3.35 is something approximate value for the base width B. Now let us see where it in a figure. That is my figure. Okay, this one is your base width. Okay, and it is it including the toe slab, heel slab, and the middle portion. Okay, so let me determine the width of the toe slab. Width of toe slab will be 1/3 of this particular base width as per the middle third rule.
Okay, and it will be 1/3, 3.35 is 1.12 meter. So let's take round off value, something 1.2 meter. Okay. And I'm also taking round off value for the 3.35, something 4 meter. So if base width, let me write, base width is after round of 4 meter, toe width 1.2 meter, so definitely we can see the heel width will be 1.2 meter. Now let me write this dimension values, whatever we determine for the base width in the drawing. So I find the total base width value is 4 meter. Then toe width slab value is 1.2 meter. And we have to determine the heel slab value and the middle portion value. And this middle portion value, we say it is a bottom width of the stem, as we know that this particular portion, we know it is a stem. So this particular distance is something a top width of the stem, and this one is a bottom width of the stem, and we have to find this one. We also have to find this particular depth of the base width, or we can say thickness of the base width. Okay, so the thickness of the base width for the thumb rule formula, I can take it is a capital H by 12 to capital H by 15, as our capital H is 6.7 meter by 12 to 6.7 divided by 15. After calculation, I am getting the value 0.55 to 0.44. so I would like to take value between somewhere 0.55 to 0.44, and it is 0.5 meter. Okay, so let's see in the figure. I am taking this particular thickness of the base width is 0.5 meter. Now we have to determine this particular distance, and it is a thickness of the, it is a bottom thickness of the stem. And as we have discussed earlier, that the stem is subjected with a backfill pressure, and that is the active earth pressure. You can see here in this diagram. Okay, and it is acting at 1/3 of the height distance from the bottom of the wall. Okay, now we have to find this particular thickness, as in bottom thickness of the stem, it is somewhere up to here. Okay, so we have to consider this pressure diagram up to this distance only, and our this particular height is 6.2 meter. We have determined previously. Now let's draw the pressure diagram up to the base of the stem, and this value will be Ka gamma small h. Here my small h is particular height of stem, and it is 6.2 meter. Okay,
So the pressure at the base of the stem, here it is K gamma small h, is 1 by 3 as in K, gamma as in 18, and small h is 6.2. Now, as we want to find this particular thickness of the stem, and we have to take moment about this particular depth. Okay, so let's take these force with a moment, and we know that what is moment? Moment is nothing but the force into perpendicular distance. Here our force is capital PA multiplied by perpendicular distance is small h by 3. It is a CG of the triangle. Okay, our PA will be 1 by 2 into 1 by 3. It is area of the triangle, 18 into h by 2 square. Okay, multiply by h by 3. Okay, and after calculation I'm getting the value something 238.3, as it is a moment, the unit will be kilonewton into meter. Now we know that we used to do the factor moment for the RCC calculation. Factor moment you can denote as mu, and the multiplication factor is 1.5, and the value is something 357.48 kilonewton into meter. Now with using the formula given in SP16 for mu is 0.138 fck BD square. We already determine our moment MU is 357.48 as it is given in kilonewton into meter, and here I want to convert in newton into mm. So I'm just multiplying it with 10 raised to 6. It is newton into mm. 0.138 FCK, we are taking 20. What is B? It is per meter width, so I'm taking 1000, and D we want to determine. So after calculation, I determine the value of D is 359.89 mm. Okay, so let me round off. After adding concrete cover both of the side, here after adding concrete cover both of the side, something value I'm taking round off, it is 450 mm. Okay, now as we have determined this particular bottom thickness is 450 mm, nothing but 0.45 meter. Now what is remaining value? The value remaining is width of the heel slab, and it will be capital B minus heel slab minus 0.45. okay, so let's determine that. Width of the heel slab, small b minus, sorry, it is small b 4 meter minus 1.2 minus 0.45, and you have the value is 2.5. 35 meters. So let's draw this value in our diagram. We have find the width of heel slab. It is 2.35. Okay. Now we have to determine this top thickness of the stem. As you can see, this is the stem having a shape, something trapezoidal shape. So as we have determined, the bottom thickness is 0.45 meter. So this will be definitely smaller than 0.45, and with rough value I am taking is 0.2 meter. And here we are done with our determination of all dimensions of the components of retaining wall. Determine the forces acting on the retaining wall with the moments and perpendicular distance from the particular point. Here you can see the diagram of all horizontal and vertical forces acting on the retaining wall. Okay, here you can see this is a horizontal force acting as an active earth pressure from the backfill side. Okay, similarly the passive earth pressure will be acting from the opposite side of the backfill side. Okay, but these passive earth pressure we are taking at a time of calculation factor of safety against sliding. Okay, now the vertical forces are nothing but the dead load of this particular retaining wall, this stem, and by the base width. Okay, you can see here that W1 and W2 is a dead load of this particular stem, then W3 is a dead load of the base width, and W4 is a dead load of the shear key. Shear key is a provided to safety against the sliding of the retaining wall, and we can assume the dimension of shear key is something 45 meter to 0.5 meter. You can see the dimension here. Okay, now these W5 is a dead load of the backfill. You can see to resist these vertical download forces, there is a forces coming from the soil, which is from the upward side. Okay, and this is a uplift pressure diagram from the soil. And we have to determine these P maximum and P minimum values. Now let's calculate the horizontal forces. If I want to write for the horizontal forces, the load type is active earth pressure. Let's see in the drawing. You can see here our horizontal force is acting from the backfill side. It is our active earth pressure. Okay, now what is the value of this particular force? We determine that is capital PA. It is 1/2 K gamma H square. Okay, and the value is 134.67. As it is a force, you should write in kilonewton. Okay, now we have to determine the moment of this particular force at a point A. Now where is the point A? I can show you. It is the end point at the toe slab. You can see this one is my point A. So you have to determine the moment of these force at this particular point. So we have to determine the perpendicular distance from the point A, and as it is a triangle, so the perpendicular distance is nothing but the CG of the triangle. So it is 6.7 divided by 3, and it is something 2.23 in meter. Okay, now moment is nothing but the force into perpendicular distance. So here our moment is 134.67 multiplied by 2.23 It is somewhat 300.31 kilonewton into meter. This horizontal force is called as a sliding force, and it will be acting from this direction. And this moment is called overturning moment, and it is acting counterclockwise. And if it is counterclockwise, it is acting this, sorry. Now our next step is we have to determine the uplift pressure. You can see here, this is the uplift pressure diagram, and we have to determine the P maximum and P minimum value. To determine this, first of all we have to determine the resultant force, and we know that what is a resultant force. Let's say there is a simple cross section of our retaining wall, okay, with the base width, we know that there is a vertical forces, vertical downward forces, and there will be the horizontal forces acting like this. So what is the resultant forces? Resultant forces will be due to the horizontal and the vertical forces, it is somewhere acting like here, okay. And if I am sigma V, and there will be sigma H. Okay, now let's determine some, if this is my base width B, and we know that there is a rule that our resultant force should be fall in the middle third portion of the base width. So let I am dividing this base width in three different portion, and they are here is B by 3, B by 3, and B by 3. Okay, our R should be fall at middle third of the base. Okay, so we have to determine where your R should be fall from the toe point. Let's say this is your first toe point A, and you have to denote a distance is x bar, and the x bar is the distance of point of application of resultant force from the toe point A. Okay, you can see this, the x bar is a distance from the toe point A to the where it fall at the middle third portion of the base slab. Okay, now here I am determine the CG of the base slab, that is something B by 2. And what is my eccentricity? Eccentricity is a remaining distance from the x bar to B by 2. So your eccentricity is equal to B by 2 minus x bar. We have to determine all of the values to determine the uplift pressure diagrams. Now if we want to determine the value of x bar, we have to equate the two moments. One moment from the resultant, moment due to resultant force, is equal to net moment from the all of the forces which are subjected with a retaining wall. net moment at point A, which is at toe point, right? Now what is moment due to resultant forces? It is nothing but sigma V multiply by x bar. As you can see, sigma V multiply by x bar, and the net moment will be your difference between the resisting moment and the overturning moment. And we know that our resisting moment is somewhere what 923, and the overturning moment is around 300.3. so I am writing this difference between the resisting moment and the overturning moment. Now we want to determine the x bar value, so it is something like this, sigma v. I already calculated the resisting moment. Wait, I will show you what is the resisting moment. We determine the, yes, you can see here, this one is we determine a moment due to the vertical forces, and that is nothing but your resisting moment, and it is in clockwise direction. And the overturning moment is due to our active earth pressure, it is in anti-clockwise direction. Okay, so the value I determine for the x bar is something 1.69 meter. Now our next step is to determine the eccentricity, and what is the eccentricity? Something b by 2 minus x bar, and I find the value is 0.31 meter. Now determine the uplift pressure diagram. For the uplift pressure diagram, we know the formula. To determine P maximum, it is something vertical load divided by area plus moment due to eccentricity upon Z, and P minimum will be P by A minus M by Z. Again, we have some criteria that P maximum should be less than your SVC, which is your soil bearing capacity, and it should be more than zero. Okay, so I think we know that P minimum should not be goes to negative, or it should not be zero. If it is goes to negative, then tension will be generated in your soil and your structure will be fail. Now I'm drawing the pressure diagram, and it is a pressure uplift pressure diagram. P minimum, P maximum. Okay, as it is a uplift soil pressure, so the arrows will be going to upward, and the formula for P maximum is P by A plus M by Z. Now let's understand each and every parameter one by one. What is P here? It is simpler your sigma V, or it's your vertical forces. We know that our sigma V is 368.26 in kilonewton. For the area, we have to consider the base area of the wall. B is your width of the base slab, and here we are considering 1 meter in longitudinal direction, so it will be B. What is M? M is your moment due to the vertical forces multiplied by the eccentricity. Okay, we know that the vertical forces we determine 368.28 multiplied by the eccentricity we have find is 0.31 meter. And what is Z? So Z is our section modulus. We know that a section modulus formula is BD square by 6. So here we are taking our length in per meter, and here our depth will be the considering as the width of the base slab. So it will be denoting as B square divided by 6. So your Z will be B square by 6. Now let's put all this formula into the equation.
P maximum will be sigma V upon area plus M by Z. Okay, sigma V is 328.26 divided by area is 1 multiplied by B. So our B is here 4. Then M is nothing but P multiplied by E, and the section modulus Z. And I have find the value is something 134.86 kilonewton per meter square. Okay, now let's determine for the P minimum. P minimum is something sigma V upon A minus M by Z. Let's put the values 328.26 divided by 1 by 4 minus 328.26 multiplied by your E is something 0.31 and your section modulus is something 4 square by 6. And I have got the value is something 49.25 kilonewton per meter square. Now let's consider both are the values satisfied the criterias or not. As we know that our P maximum should be less than SVC, and our SVC is something 170 kilonewton per meter square. So it is 170 kilonewton per meter square, and here we are satisfying this complete criteria, and definitely we know that our P minimum should be more than zero, and here we are satisfying the criteria. So let's draw these values in our diagram. Okay, and our P minimum is here something 49.25 kilonewton per meter square, and P maximum, which is less than SVC already, and it is 135.86 kilonewton per meter square. Now we have to determine factor of safety. First, factor of safety against overturning, and second is factor of safety against sliding. So let's first determine the factor of safety against overturning. Formula is moments due to resisting. It means our resisting moment and overturning moment. We know that our resisting moment is nothing but the moment due to the vertical forces, and our overturning moment is the moment due to the horizontal forces. Okay, and our values are MR upon MO. They are moment of resisting is something 923.49. I'm showing you. We have determined the vertical forces, and whatever moment of resisting we can find, it is 923.4 kilonewton into meter, and they are in clockwise direction. And the overturning moment I have determined 300.31 in the anti-clockwise direction, right? So here it is 300.3 kilonewton into meter. Okay, and the value we have find is something 3.077, and definitely it is more than 1. It should be more than 1.5, and here we are in safe criteria. So whatever components we are assumed, and we can say the whatever dimension of the components we are assumed here, and the whatever forces are acting due to these types of components, they are safe. Now let's check the factor of safety against sliding. For this, first of all, let's understand how this sliding force affects on the retaining wall. Let I am drawing here a simple cross section of the retaining wall with the base slab. Okay, and definitely we are here already provided shear key for the safety against sliding. Okay, then how the forces are acting, we know that our active earth pressure is subjected with some like this. It is nothing but your horizontal force. Okay, and passive earth pressure will be somewhere like this. We know that it is Kp gamma, this particular height. Okay, it is somewhere acting Pp at the CG of this particular triangle, and there will be the friction force will be acting with this direction in terms of resisting of the active earth pressure. And we know that what is the friction, it requires your mu sigma v. Okay, and we know that the mu is a coefficient of friction. So as per our understanding, our active earth pressure will be act as a sliding force, as this force is try to slide your wall with the help of backfill soil, right? So here our PA is we already determined something 134.67 kilonewton. The direction of this particular force is from here. Now what is your friction force, which is in opposite direction? Okay, and similarly, what is your opposite direction force? It is nothing but your passive earth pressure. Okay, now if let if we are calculating both, it is something mu sigma v plus the passive earth pressure is area of this particular small triangle 1 by 2 kp gamma h1 square. Here my h1 is the h one is this particular depth of the base slab and the depth of the shear key. So it is 0.5 plus 0.5, and you can say the our h1 is 1 meter. Okay, now let me calculate this particular. I think our mu is already given to us, and it is coefficient of friction 0.5. okay, sigma v is 368.26 plus 1/2 kp is 3, sigma is the density of a soil, which is 18. Okay, and h1 is 1, and I am calculating here the total resisting force is 211.13 kilonewton, and the direction of these resisting forces opposite to the active earth pressure, and it is nothing but our sliding force. Okay, so what is the factor of safety against sliding? It is resisting force divided by sliding force. And we get the value is something, our resisting force is 113, and something 134.6, and we can get the value is 1.57. It should be more than 1.5, and here we are in safe zone.